It's quite a unique event that we are having today in here because our speakers today are Collective Centrala, which is together with our school from the very first year of its foundation, and working with students, providing workshops every semester with their quite interesting and unconventional methodologies. And today is the first time that Centrala is present in our school physically, finally, after 2 years of the full-scale invasion, and they have joined us to provide their amazing workshop for our students, as they usually do, and to share with you their experiences and researchers and practice, which is dealing with architecture in a different way that usually we think about the architecture. So it's everything we can think about of natural phenomena, how it can influence people and architecture, and on this intersection between nature and human built environment. So I would like to introduce to you Malgorzata Kucewicz and Simon de Jacobis, the founders of the Collective Centrala, and give a word to them. So please give a warm round of applause for our speakers.
Thank you. Thank you for having us. We are so happy to be here, and like it's such an honor and privilege to. We are so thankful for the school, because actually thanks to the series of worship that we've been conducting since 2018, we've been like learning from the students much more than we have taught them. So for us, it's an unfair exchange at the end of the day.
Our practice is... maybe just one. So our practice is mostly rotating around that term, amplified nature. We believe that as architect, we can amplify the nature, and nature can amplify our projects. Today we're gonna to share with you like two lines of our research connected to this topic, designing with nature. First part will be the outcome of 2-3 years long research that we did with the team of Museum of Warsaw. We started that in the pandemic in 2020, while we've been maybe 19. So we were like interested who, in fact, rebuilt greenery in Warsaw after World War II.
We found like repetitively. Before delving into this, part of our practice comes from the reading the biography of places, and this reading the biography of places led us to several encounters with masters of modernity, sometimes masters which are still alive, and this is the case of a person that we couldn't interview ourselves, but we could at least interview some of the people that work with her, that are still alive. Now they are no longer. In fact, one of the former colleagues of Alina Scholz died during the pandemic, in fact. And therefore, like a big strain of our research delves into the past in order to understand how we can actually design our future better. The name of Alina Scholz came oftentimes in publication connected with the reconstruction of Warsaw just as an addition, some added name at the end of the project after a long list of male architects that were involved in the doing the buildings, doing the urban fabric, and then there was this gardens by Alina Scholz. So we started wondering who's this figure, who's this woman that is so much entangled with the project of the landscape in post-war Warsaw. We did in 2021, in fact, after this 2 years research, an exhibition on her in the local municipal museum in the sub-district of Opola, we're trying to focus basically on a full panorama of the scope of her work, like beginning from the interwar periods, projects when she was very young, up until the full development of her career in the early post-war periods, up until the late 60s, early 70s, when we can find the latest scope of her projects.
Today we're going to share what we have learned from her, what architects can learn from landscape architects, because for us it was like an extremely like a formative experience. First of all, landscape architecture is dealing with a completely different time spans, and this is what for us is inspiring in terms of looking for a solution for the climate change, for the climate catastrophe. We do believe that now we also face the same challenges like after the Second World War. That means that we need to make the city much more green and much more like connected to the natural processes. So that was the first lesson from Alina Scholz, that she had to wait decades for the outcomes of her proposals. So when this is something obvious, but we're gonna to say some of this stuff just to illustrate what is useful as a design toolbox for architects. So when she finished the designs, it looked like that. So only this knowledge of the landscape architect, you could predict that in the few decades it's gonna look like that. This is the place where Friedrich Chopin was born, so now it's like a monument park. And she was operating there during the war. So she was gathering herself, she was cutting the trees, she was doing all the works, and this is how she learned a lot. Even if it was not her own design, she was working for a professor. She was implementing his design, but we think that it was a formative realization because she was doing that with her own body.
There's also to say that, like in the exhibition, we found like the sketchbook of her professor. This Czerna Polkowski, this like male role that was sort of like her mentor. And we could see that they were trying to implement solutions that were actually copy-pasting from a British landscape design that was at the time referenced to look up to, such as Brenda Colvin or Sir Geoffrey Jellicoe. So those are like landscape architects who, of the gardens that they could actually possibly only imagine or they had the chance to visit during some study visits. And we depart maybe from the garden of the Frédéric Chopin kind of cottage, because that was sort of like not only the learning ground, but we found there so many solutions that then she went on in implementing in later project. Almost if this would be sort of like a textbook that she was always like referring to in the future designs.
It was not shocking only for us, but for people who are interested in architecture, in the structure of Warsaw, that nobody before asked how it happened that our city is green again. Because the project was so well implemented that it looked so natural, the greenery of Warsaw, from our perspective, that nobody understood that it was somebody's concept, implemented and realized. And we have a lot of books about who and how and why produce the buildings in such a way, not other one. But the green matter of the city, it was invisible subject as well because it was realized mostly by women. So she was the head of the greenery office, and most of the work was done by girls and young women in Warsaw. So that's the main part in Warsaw, the Saski garden. And you can see that she was treating the leftovers with very big esteem, but she was imposing quite a mathematical composition on top of it. This guy garden was not found before the Second World War. It was fenced. It was it had this kind of Versailles kind of look, so it was very formal. And what Alina Scholz did, and it's one of the lessons that we have learned from her, she used ancient patterns for the plant Buddha trees. So she used this very geometrical layout, quintus, to create such a composition, which is called diamond composition. You can see that, for example, from lovely perspective from walls.
I think like that what Gosha mentioned regarding the let's say the idea on how to rebuild greenery, which is fully public, is super important in a sense of political change and like attitude, social attitude towards like what is like public good. Like if you imagine like this passage from a fenced garden from the aristocracy to an urban forest for the People's Republic of Poland, this is like this part went to a radical shift. And one element that we stressed out during the lecture is dealing with this, let's say, historical trees, the trees that survived the war, and also what is the consequence for a tree to survive a war. We heard from biologists that actually the way in which a tree grows is heavily influenced by the blast of the bombs. So in a sense, if the tree was in the presence of a blast, then it's all physiognomy and the relationship with the environment changes, and still is possible nowadays to trace which old trees were actually affected. So for us, it's very interesting to imagine how valuable were for these post-war thinkers those trees, and the implementation of the quincunx somehow went into the parallel of architecture and the landscape, in a sense of this very modern idea that a tree is a column is a tree, so we can in a sense reuse the trees to reinterpret the column of a palace that is no longer there. Nowadays in Warsaw there is the discussion of whether to rebuild the Saxon Palace, which was at the very end of the Saxon Park, while Alina Scholz back in the days when they constructed this park, imagine that the trees could be the former columns of the park, and this is as much memory as we need. We don't need to rebuild literally the building. The trees are the living memory of this architecture.
But this ancient Renaissance way of representing the trees in this quincunx manner is giving a different perception of the park, because while you're moving through such a structure, it's becoming like cinematic. So the trees are not creating one wall; they are always like giving you this this kind of structure that you can look away, and it's really like moving in front of your eyes. So she was really using that that solution for many places in Warsaw. And this cinematic aspect of being into the urban greenery is very important in her composition. So not only in that moment, but we'll expand that later. Of course, the seasonality was something that she used a lot. She was using the plants in a way that they were like changing the scenography in the city in seasons, and she was using the evergreen plants as a contrapoint. And one of the first post-war realization was connected to the military decision of rebuilding the east-west connection, so-called East-West Road, and rebuilding the old. And you can see here this new bridge on a curve. She realized these column trees, and it was connected to the history of the place and to the fact that we had the leftovers of the columns. You can see the Varsovian column there on the right. It was completed, of course, but in front of the trees, she collected like the
disco.
Yeah. So So that was a, of course, that was rebuilt, but she collected the old old columns here in such a small lapidarium. So those trees were somehow informing that the this lapidary, the original materiality of the place is there. That's one of the aspects that we wanted to share. And the second one is connected with this group of colorful trees. So using this palette of different colors in different seasons, she was creating a scenography according to the
national holidays.
National holidays.
Well, and here you can see
these national colors
that are actually present during, especially during the celebration, which are happening mostly in May. Maybe two things that I would like to stress out in this picture, like the relationship between the column trees and the bell towers of the church on the other side of the river. So there's always a dialogue, a relationship established between the design of the landscape and the surrounding monuments, monumental architecture. But for me, two concepts are important, that each like kind of airport, like a, being that like the one of a building or the one of an infrastructure, in this case like a sort of like an highway, it's also a project of landscape. So in this sense, we try to recover the disciplines of landscape design as a foundational to the every architectural gesture we do in the city. A road, it's landscape before being a road. And the edges of this east-west connection are very clearly like a green space for people. The second thing that I would like to stress out is that it's not only about the colors of these trees, it's also about the quality of these trees, because those were fruit trees. Those are like apples and pear trees. So the idea of bringing back the type of trees which are normally typical of orchards, or like allotment gardens, into the public nature is very important for the smells, for the fruits, for the presence of this everydayness of like picking an apple or taking a pear. So I think that the this project, I mean the landscape around the east-west road, aims at humanizing the infrastructure.
Symbolic, of course, with these so-called national clouds, she was calling them in such a way. So they were like present, there is, for example, the 10th of May, when we have the national holiday of the flag, so why the red flag, of course. But the other maneuver that she experimented with huge success was to plant already like a grown trees. She, during the war, she was checking what is waiting in the Polish nurseries, and she was like a great admirer of the linens? Linden trees. And this action of planting next to that road was famous, because in one night, 30 years old trees appear in the center of the reconstruction. So it was very like a highly magical for the Warsawians that suddenly this kind of crater became like a green again, just in one night. And of course, when you think about the highway, you can see the greenery from the perspective of the pedestrian, but mostly from the perspective of the driver. And she was like really into this different time span of
of perceiving the landscape. So this like this
kind of timescale perception that you're perceiving the landscape while walking, while driving, and so on and so forth, while being in a tram, while driving, while walking by riding a bicycle, and further we'll see even by riding a horse. Okay, here we just put up the slide to emphasize this materiality of the lapidarium, which is a theme that will be recurrent in the further projects in show. And here it is, in fact, the a project, one of the most important projects that she contributed to realize, it was a garden for the horse race track in the Sugeris district of Warsaw, like a flagship modernist project. You have to imagine that basically one of the crucial points of modernity was represented by speed, by horse race, by sanitization and streamlined modernism, which is this project is all accepted for. And the tall tree is planted alongside the horse race track. They kind of like, in a sense, accompany the pace of a horse ride. So in a sense, this rhythmus goes together with the performativity of the horse race.
I'm showing you the happy pictures, but we experienced that space with on the bikes, and really taking your ride with similar speed to the horse, you can really enjoy all that play of the shadows and sounds. That you can even like feel the rhythms of the horses, even being on the bicycle. The other seasonal solutions that they should implement are connected to the social estates. So she was planting these kinds of trees on the roads into the schools, because those trees are becoming red at the beginning of September. So they created like a colorful gates for kids to welcome them to the school again. As well, she was planting a lot of chestnut trees next to the kindergartens, because she knew that the kids are doing the chestnut
figures.
So she was thinking that, in a very like, beautiful way. But for us, the of course, the microclimatic aspect of the composition is something that we try to as well share here with the students. That the mass of greenery is acting like a mass of the building. So it's creating wind pockets, it's sometimes accelerating the wind, sometimes it's blocking the wind. Sometimes the composition of the landform and the greenery is creating a frost pocket. So creating compositions with landforms and the greenery for Alina Scholz was not only about making beautiful spaces or colorful spaces or cultural scenography, it was mostly about creating a better condition for living in urban environment. And we will start with the landforms, because that was the main topic for the architects and urban and landscape architects after the Second World War. Of course, Warsaw is a post-catastrophic city, so we had such a number, such a volume of ruins and troubles that was the first design decision, what to do with them. Fortunately, Alina Scholz had some pre-war experiences with forming landforms, because she was realizing the park around this mound in Krakow, and then she had learned that, for example, placing the paths on the hill, it's not only about the ergonomy of climbing up, but it's about conducting the water down. Because the water, while it's not like invited to choose the road by for example, the composition of the paths, of course it can be like destructive. It can destruct the mound. And she used that knowledge in her post-war compositions. That's our the most dear one for us.
Actually, we had like slightly manipulative, and we're permitted that we're never telling you fully the truth during our lecture. So in fact, Alina Scholz was like also the chief of a very large office of the reconstruction of Warsaw. So sometimes she was not fully the author of the project, but maybe she was signing or like kind of advising or correcting the project of like a younger landscape designers. In the case of this project, we found her name only in the first master plan. But we want to think that she had like a large influence on the landscape designers that were actively executing this design. This is a park in West Warsaw, next to hallmark modernist estate of Kowo, in which she basically sort of like recovered former clay pits in shaping them as retention basin lakes in which the water was guided and channeled and somehow accumulated to the a smart conveyor system that you can see in both this picture and the previous picture. So the mound in question is realized with post-World War II wreckage and converted into a ski track.
So it's an artificial mound.
It's an artificial mound. In fact, it's like Warsaw does not have hills, so all the hills in Warsaw are actually artificial hills. And this specific kind of wavy landform for us is extremely important because it absolves both the function of preventing the skiers from falling down the hill and guided the snow melting and rainwater down all the way down to the retention basins that she created out of these former clay pits. With Gosha, we made ourselves like a tiny clay model of this project in order to try to understand the physics of it. We have even a theory that Alina Scholz learned of some of this solution after returning from China, where she designed the reception garden for the Polish embassy in Beijing. Because in the traditional Chinese garden, there is this kind of elements. The border between two lakes, it's a sort of like a tiny kind of hill that basically allows for you to walk between when the water is low, but for the water to overspill when there is too much. So this is how the park worked. When the snow accumulated alongside the slope and it melted, it flowed in the first basin, then from the first basin went to the second one, and then all the way into the rest of the hill, into the rest of the ponds, and up until the last one, which is like the deepest, as the ultimate overspill.
So we understood that the rollings and rubbers was like a materiality that the landscape designer used to conduct wind and water in the post-war wars. Of course, with the destruction, the Warsaw became like an open city structure. Pre-war it was very dense, very like a closed structure. But after the war, there was much more emptiness than the built tissue. So that project was very important. So we're going a bit aside of Alina Scholz's research to share with you some other findings that we got in the connection to that materiality, this post-war metabolism, let's call it. So this is Murano district where I was raised as a kid, and this district is realized on the pile of ruins and rubbles, and it was built with the ruins and rubbles because the buildings are created with the so-called concrete. But this is a well-known story. This is a topic of many researchers, especially now when we're talking about the reuse in architecture, how we can recycle the buildings when they finish in their lifespan. So for us, it took us some years, in fact, but at one point we realized that the volume was so big that we counted the states created with the ruins, we counted the mountains, but still there was two less ruins and rubbles in Warsaw. So we found them. We found them in the river, in the Vistula River, that was regulated with that materiality.
Yeah, as Gosha mentioned, there was a need of actually disposing of this volume of post-World War II wreckage, and simultaneously an idea that back then that the Vistula River would be rather like a channel for water transportation, so it had to be somehow secured and regulated. So already in the pre-war period, like this red element that you see in the map, these tiny spores started to appear in order to kind of reduce its course and deepen its bed. In the post-war period, thanks to the rubbles, those spurs were elongated. The rubbles was loaded on metal barges carried on the right river bank, and with the rubbles and the vitrina, the reeds, some sort of like layers, of like sandwiches of beds were created so that that the river would symbiotically deposit mud, sands, silts, and gravel in between. So for the ones of you that maybe had the chance of visiting Warsaw and remember this very lush and green right riverbank and thinks that it's like a natural, wonderfully natural environment, it isn't. It's manly. It's anthropogenic, and the interesting part is the fact that it's constituted together with the river. We really like this symbiotic aspect of this operation. We presented this project in framework of a tiny exhibition organized by the National Institute of Architecture and Urbanism, where we showed that actually this spreading of the materiality of Warsaw went far beyond the border of the city itself. It extended for even 361 kilometers from the city of Puławy to the city of Toruń. So in a sense, if you think of the materiality of the city as this kind of metabolic force, you can find the traces of Warsaw all over, like an entire region. We like this idea that even like these bricks, they were coming from the river because they were made with the sand of the river, and then they returned to the river, paradoxically. This is an illustration made by a colleague of ours, Alexandra Zestowska, to whom we asked to actually illustrate this graffito technique that is normally present on the reconstructed buildings of Warsaw, this process of collecting the wreckage, loading it on the barges, on the boats, then harvesting the reeds and slowly creating these matrices of reeds and wreckage in order to create the spurs that then only end up in the regulating river.
It's not only about the pragmatism, it's as well touching the subject of the memory state, of the like how to create a landscape which is mnemonic, which is like helping generations to remember what happened. And it's very like a life topic, because even after seven decades we still like trying to understand some manipulation with the common memory, like for example the Jewish heritage was completely covered for decades, and only last decades we understood what is hidden by even architecture. So as Simona said, this is something important to us, that most of the buildings in Warsaw, most of the concrete in Warsaw is created with the Vistula sand. So there are those periods that the Vistula is co-creating architecture, and then as well it's like taking absorbing it because a lot of materials was dumped into the Vistula. The other thing that we were focused last year was on first comers to the brackets of Warsaw, because of this Alina Scholz lens on the greenery, we wanted to understand more with whom we are sharing the space, with which kind of plants, which kind of species. And we were following the post-war surveys, and we understood that still in the cityscape we have those plants which came as first, and which came from behind the ruins, from the Jewish gardens, for example, on the Victoria, or came with the wind as first to the city. So with the botanist, because it was not so easy, from 45 species, even using botanical bands of the seeds, we were able to wanted to create like an outdoor exhibition of those plants which are present in Warsaw, but they were never like displayed. And with Natalia Budnik, that we working a lot, landscape architect, we created that display with the Jewish Institute as well for the last summer, for people to understand better that those plants which are like common or like nobody's noticing them, that in fact there are those survivors or those who are came first, or that they're like a highly symbolic as well.
I think maybe it's important to say that yeah, as Gosha mentioned, those plants are considered normally weeds to be kind of removed, so they don't have like any like botanical value. You wouldn't find them in the botanical garden as like a protected species, but they can. They're not only pioneering on a very hard condition. I mean, they're like survivors in a true sense. They kind of sometimes they can they could live in the ground for years before the right moment appears to actually sprout again. And they took advantage of the fact that no other plant can compete in that time of the afterworld wreckage for that very barren and somehow dry soil. So somehow we like to think that that no matter what like the violence that we can impose on a landscape, like the plant life will always find a way to try it in certain moment.
All of them, there are like maximum 2 year species, 1 or 2 year species. So after the display, we cut them out, we collected the seeds, and with the local kids, we seed them in the like a neighborhood. So we're hoping that in the next weeks, we're gonna meet them again in the surrounding. An idea for the composition by Natalia was that she used these high forms to create the marsh of the plants. So like a symbolic composition.
Maybe I just want to add, if some of you would be interested in this kind of research, it was not unique to Warsaw. The botanist that did this research in post-World War II wreckage was called Roman Kobenza, and he had like parallel botanists working with like with the bombing of London or the one of Amsterdam, and they were like engaged in understanding what kind of plants would appear first after the aftermath of the war. And they collected this information, they photographed, they archived, and they made like an extensive commentary. So if any of you would be interested in this kind of material, we can share with you articles and photographs and accounts of these histories.
And of course, it's a very rewarding for us as designers that it's enough to put on the pedestal, you know, like common plants, and suddenly people are super interested in them. So it's the power of the exhibition. And coming back to Alina Scholz's research, which is like a constant inspiration, she was using the ruins and rubbles not only to shape the river like a bed, but as well the escarpment. We have in Warsaw this geological formation, which is following the river, this that hill, which is like a backbone of the urban composition. So all the important institutions are like placed on the edge of it, with the view to the east, like the National Museum, like all the universities and so on. So it's like a highly prestigious place. And Alina Scholz was, with her office, of course, she was highly shaping that that slope. Here you can see the chart of the different species of lianas, because what they understood in the wartime, that we had like a specific type of lianen for Warsaw. So it's the only plant which has even the name in Latin, Prasalianus. So unfortunately, it's a lianen which is much more linden, which is much more like resilient to the drought. very important now because Alina shows use the this pieces a lot, and because like half of Warsaw is doing this planted with that tree, and now Warsaw is like drying. It's like the biggest challenge in front of us, but fortunately that is our partner. Yeah. So what we learned from Alina Scholl's composition is this urban forest attitude, that you have to think about the different lifespan of the trees. So when you making the composition, it's you have to take in the consideration that some of these, they will last only like a few decades, some of others will last a few hundred years. And you have to think in this like a transgressive compositions, that if you even want to achieve very green city very fast, this greenery will die very fast, because this is the rule. It can be growing fast, is, the lifespan is short. To like illustrate this transition in time, Alina Scholl was always drawing trees as spirals, which are growing in time. So even on the such a drawings, you could understand which trees are like ancient and which are like Indies.
And again, on this notation for our students, we're always challenging you to try to represent the processual phenomena in architecture. So this is like one kind of like tiny hint. So imagine like a growth in the form of a spiral, in a sense of like an expansion, like something that is like almost like a constellation. And this the path that she realized on the slope of the riverbed was considered like back then a sort of was actually promoted as an horizontal form of the Palace of Culture, or sort of like a garden for the masses, where like a mass gathering and could happen, where like this new society would actually gather and.
We are ready the time, are we supposed to be careful? So here you can see some square in the park, and you can see that the trees are sunken. So even if they remodeled the level at the square, they kept the original levels for the pre-war trees. So by reading this kind of details, you can read if the tree was before the landscape or it came after the landscape. And this is a symbolic drawing to us because we conducted other like research on Zofia and Oskar Hansen, so modern architects. And this is the student drawing of Zofia Hansen. And apparently she was studying under the eye of Alina Scholl, because this is this very like characteristic type of trees that Alina Scholl was drawing. So she put some trees on the Hansen proposal. And so it's very like for us important because it's showing this transfer of knowledge to the generations of the Polish landscape women architects, which is beautiful.
So back in 2019, together with Natalia Budnik, again with whom we collaborated very, very often, we did like a competition for a park, and inspired by the teachings of Alina Scholl, in which we thought that the park was supposed to be dedicated to paratroopers, and we decided that actually this kind of being carried by the wind, like being a little bit like at the, let's say, at the mercy of the natural winds, would be like the main subject of our planting, of our the design for the park. So we decided to base the entire planting on trees which are actually spreading through wind. So that was the specifics of the logic that we applied to this competition. And also the architecture of the small architecture in the park would also be reactive to the wind. This is a little bit what we're trying to also teach here, that the aspect of design together with the natural forces and not against that. So for architecture to be informed by the wind, the idea of the pavilion was to be actually modeled by geometry normally applied to the winglets of airplanes. So in a sense, this aerodynamic forms of the cafe and the communal spaces underground, crisscrossing the bike paths and the walk paths, would enhance your experience of wind by kind of like slowing down the wind or accelerating and exacerbating the power of the wind in a certain point. So the entire, we conceive the entire part from A to Z as a wind-based experience.
The price, but not the first one, and the jury was laughing that there, some of them they have allergies from this type of plants, so it would be the nightmare for them to go to this kind of park, which is all based on, you know, species in airborne species. The biggest and most important lesson from Anna Scholz, which is the background of our many projects, is a lesson on hydrobotany. In fact, connection between hydrobotany and architecture. Thanks to Anna Scholz, we understood that all architects in Europe, they forget how to deal with the water plants. And we try to recover it. In fact, Anna Scholz was designing great propositions for wetlands. And the water plants were like her signature. So you can see, for example, here, the Polish garden for the Polish pavilion for the Expo in 1937. So the garden was much more important than the architecture around. And you can see the pond with the special pockets for the soil, for the water release to appear. So that garden was like an exhibition of the Polish landscape. And in fact, it was noticed by the critics because the Polish pavilion was not called Polish pavilion, but Polish garden. So we had different pavilions at the Expo. All of them, they got a postcard, the subtitle. And the Polish composition was subtitled Polish garden. In fact, it's a classical project to teach about students in Poland, but before nobody noticed the garden itself. I mean, we know by heart all the shapes, architectural shapes, but this garden composition was like the theme of the museum did that from scratch. So that's some models of the cycling project.
Of course, I don't know if you recognize some of the names of the architects. They were like the most important architects alive at the time, both from the, let's say, retrograde, like Bogdan Pniewski of the interwar period, but and the most avant-gardist, in fact, in the modern times, such as the Duhalser, Lachert, out of the Murano estate, by the way, and in fact, Alina in the garden section.
And maybe it was forgotten because this
public
garden was placed here. And unfortunately, it was exactly in the middle between Soviet and Nazi pavilion. So even if it was like noticed at the time, with the decades, somehow historiography of architecture forgot about it. Small gesture of Alina Scholz. Other example that we wanted to share with you, as well connected into this kind of international displays of the Polish gardens is the garden which is in the best state, probably, but we have no idea because it's located in the North Korea. So we have only few satellite pictures of what's happening there now. But that garden, this garden was awarded in the 60s for the best landscape sculpture. And we did for the exhibition, we did with Simona and model makers from Animo Studio the reconstruction of it. And actually, this is like a wonderful composition which is retaining the heavy rains.
Maybe it's important to say that, like, here we're already in like late 60s, and the language of the architecture of Alina Scholz kind of like directed itself towards a more like brutalist kind of metabolic look. And we particularly love this kind of like segmented oval shape in which you can imagine that the different depth created by this separation allows for different water plants to thrive and to this almost it would be a botanical garden kind of composition in which like you can imagine that the different heights of the water, the different species of plants, and now this reacted to the surrounding of this reception garden of the Polish embassy in Pyongyang. And here our, let's say, main reference. We don't have, like, this is why I'm telling you that we're pushing you a lot in this lecture. We don't have, like, definite proof that Alina Scholz actually designed this basa na vode, this, like, base for water. But we found, like, this archival drawing, thanks to a friend which was investigating the Alina Skidniewska's archives, which was an architect which was closely working with Alina Scholz, and that historical photograph that you saw firstly of this base in a magazine from the 80s, and we decided that was so interesting, the idea that we can create a tiny, almost like pocket water garden for the city of Warsaw, where there is so much scarcity of fresh water that that like was triggered the imagination of Gosha, that actually in 2018 proposed this as a company program of our Amplifying Nature exhibition. So since 2018, we forgot how to be architects and we became water gardeners, basically. That's like, this is another important message for the students. You're learning how to be an architect because then in the future you're gonna have to forget it. And you'll have to learn other things that you don't know quite yet what they are, these things, but you're gonna, your life is gonna take you to other disciplines eventually. So we happily tending many of these pots all over the city, and not only in Warsaw, actually all over the country. We have like two in Kielce, we have three in the city of Gdańsk, and many more to come in the future. You can see that like water is way better suited to extreme heat phenomena, which are increasingly present. You know, you perfectly know the Urma Island phenomena due to the amount of concrete and asphalt to two cities. So opening up, unsealing, and introducing fresh water is fundamental to the future of our cities. And this is where the video moment. And now to a video, we will introduce basically the latest 2022 evolution of dealing with hydrobotany and architecture.
No, there's no sound.
Terrorizza forse di più di questo fantastico divario per ciò che si può verificare e quello che poi sarà realmente il risultato. In questo caso, lavorando con la natura, arriviamo a perdere questa sfera di controllo e quindi lasciamo che gli ambiti in qualche modo dettino il risultato di questo che è di fatto un processo più che un progetto.
La biodiversità aquàtica, tant de flora com de fauna, és la que té un major percentatge d'espècies en perill d'extinció a Catalunya. Per tant, tot el que sigui aprofitar aquests estanys, encara que siguin tan urbans com aquest, sempre és una bona oportunitat per conservar espècies avançades i fer un paper de conservació de biodiversitat.
Species, like as the botanist Karas Palaos mentioned at the end of the video, the water plants all over Europe are now an endangered species. So the focus of this kind of intervention is to make use of very famous architecture to promote, to actually spread and popularize the idea that we do need clean, fresh water. Not we as humans, we do as a collectivity of interspecies community, in which basically the larvae of dragonflies that you saw on the video, they are like the ultimate beneficiary of this kind of intervention. Even the administration of the pavilion that was very much sort of like preoccupied with the transformation into the aesthetic picture perfect iconicity of the Barcelona pavilion, when asking us to make a fully reversible process, that it would actually return the passing exactly as a clean slate of white pebbles as it always been, when they started seeing like dragonflies, frogs, ducks, birds appearing in the Barcelona pavilion, they understood the value of like considering the layer of nature, the amplifying nature quality of architecture that their pavilion could harbor. So for us, it was like the biggest victory to kind of incept the mindset of the directors of the Barcelona Pavilions in having them accepting a different beauty, a beauty that is not always lush, is not always green, but can rot, the water can become a little bit green, the pebbles can become a little bit brownish, and so on and so forth.
And those are the pictures that we would like to restore next, because this is a reality of the Barcelonian social estates from the 60s. It was natural that in the middle of the courtyard there was a pond, and the kids knew how to behave. The plants were cleaning the water, nobody was using the chemistry, and nobody was using electricity of the Green Area also alive. And now we don't even know how much Western Green Area is dependent on electricity and all those
and tap water.
Tap water and all these like apparatus, all the wires. And quite like I don't know even if it's said anymore. I mean it's absolute. The fact is that I was studying a decade on the Varsovian Faculty of Architecture, and then there in the courtyard we have even the special apparatus to teach students hydrobotany. And it looked like that in the 60s and 70s, but while I was studying it was always like empty and nobody knew what this apparatus is created for. So now the students are trying to
recover
it and to like, bring back this teaching device to use. And some few last pictures from Sabina Scholz's research is that home was like an obvious element of the state, but other elements were like, for example, this lapidary kind of element, so like scraps of the poor also. Sometimes it was a part of the building that doesn't exist anymore. Sometimes it was the Elam, like a very like a big stone, which was like bringing back this geological past. So she was using this kind of symbolic symbolic elements to like bring back the
no longer existing one.
The pre-war histories. This is the only nowadays like a conditions, so that's our next task. So to sum up, this Alina Scholz lesson is for us is mostly about how to create urban microclimates by dealing with the urban but alive, not aseptic water in circulation. So this is what we're trying to understand better, and this is what we're trying to teach students here. To treat as a equal, not only the, I mean, two objects, two shapes, the flow. That's Alina Scholz. Thank you, Alina. And now, maybe we can share with you what we're working now for the exhibition, which is going to push us up in June. That with a very young student, Basia, we try to illustrate the structure of the flows of the water in the Vistula River for the Varsovian public, because we think that maybe for the general public it's much better to understand that you can shape the flows of the water than you can shape the flows of the air, which is our like, final goal. So we want to know this swimming pool, a pool of flowing water that will be giving the public opportunity to like experience different types of currents. So currents that we could experience in the natural river. But of course, it's just a proposal. But hopefully, it will, through that exhibition, it will inform the people that the water in the river is not something which is like moving in constant tempo in one direction, but it's something really alive and like something which is changing twice a year. The state.
The state. We are at the bottom of the mountain there, in the Luftmeer, as Alexander Grunberg described in the S atmosphere. We are immersed in water in its gaseous state, submerged in the matter that is in a constant state of flux. Our built environment is not just surrounded by air, air is architecture. So in a sense, what we are trying to tell you is that basically to move away from the idea that water is only like of course flowing water, we consider the atmosphere like basically an immense sort of like fullness of water in its gaseous state, in which architecture is in constant dialogue and interaction. In this sense, the possibilities of modulating microclimates is pivotal to the job of the architect, and we try in our little scope through exhibitions and research to promote how this was possible, it was made possible, let's say, before the introduction of central heating systems and air conditioners in pre-modern times, when the rituals of the passing of season was cherished and practiced as a way of moderating moderating microclimate. For the purpose of doing so, we went into ethnolinguistic studies of language and forgotten language on how we name seasons that we do no longer name, but they're still there, and they are nuanced, they're not only four. We worked with like the 12 Polish phenological seasons, and we think that our devices could help us in considering not the fact that now spring is arrived, but like actually should celebrate pre-spring or like late winter and all that goes alongside the cycle. This long journey began with the inventory and the study again of the legacy of Oskar and Sofia Hansen and their students of Alina Scholz and their like cottage house in the Polish countryside, the Schumin, in the village of Schumin, where for preventing the heat to escape to the pitch of the roof, they devised a system of like putting like duvet covers of beds in between the wooden beams. We thought that the system was extremely clever, and they might have learned it from somewhere. And we went into looking into historical examples of palaces and peasant houses for other devices on how textile can influence the way we can moderate our domestic climate.
We created a traveling exhibition out of that research with our curator, and Alicia Blaska, who's an artist. So this exhibition is ongoing, it's still traveling, it's going to be shown
in the summer,
but it's going to
devices, although the exhibition traveled to UK and to Portugal, because we very much like the meaning which is written in the sound and the significance of this word. For instance, like the Mukova is like this like flycatcher. It's like probably you experience that at your grandma house at a certain moment, like this striking textile which is allowing the draft to penetrate the interior while blocking the flies to get to the food. So all this nomenclature of textile is also part of a performance, part of a ritual, of domestic rituals of clothing and unclothing the home. We divided the devices in a chromatic way because of the synesthesia, you know, the aspect of like how colors convey certain feelings. So in a sense, like warm colors such as yellow, orange, red, they convey warmth. So those are like belongs to this cold seasons textiles. Here, for instance, like an textile that was in the center, like the Najuta, was crafted in Ukraine, actually by Anna Zenobia, the Lishnik Kuzulski, like it was felt, it's a Boolean, heavy Boolean text that it was felt in the river. Also, we like this fact that we can actually produce object in symbiosis with the natural elements after the Boolean fabric is being end-dyed with natural dye for from plants. And Zenobia sank this this Boolean important textile of the house in the river in order to obtain like this fully very rich textile effect. Sorry, my voice is kind of going. But maybe this is about like the way we work, like for this project we work in a model in a scale of 1 to 10 in order to be able to have a full control of our exhibition design and to kind of
it was pandemic time, but the curator was remote, well, and this is a perfect
thing
for the
phone to be it's true, it's true. So we were showing the exhibition with the phone inside the inside the exhibition.
No, I also tell that working with art is something that was uncomfortable for us as architects at the beginning, because we had to give away the control on the how stuff looks. But after that experience with Alicia, we highly recommend that. That we don't need to have a control on how things look like. We just need to like focus on the message. And the message of the protocol is that maybe we can unplug our spaces from electricity. Maybe we can enjoy once again to clog the spaces and to unclog the spaces like our own bodies. We think that it can be like treated as any kind of a privilege. And that's it. This is our like a wheel of chronological seasons, the 13 constellations and all the meteorological
phenomenon that we're trying to cooperate. Thank you.
No problem, because I actually didn't notice it because of the richness of the material that you were showing, and I'm sure you can see that most of the audience is still here and pretty much enjoying everything. So yeah, that was an amazing lecture. So many insights about how you can actually work not only with nature, but what can you learn from history and also from the hidden part, which is not on the textbook. And I'm just willing to open this round of questions from our public. But firstly, I think I just wanted to bring up the sentence that touched me very much at the beginning of your lecture about what does it mean for the tree to survive the war. And when thinking about Ukrainian cities, we're talking so much about the reconstruction and reconstructing homes and cities as we think about them as a built environment. And then thinking about the post-war Warsaw, I can imagine how much pollution was there also that you can even see on the plants how it impacted. So I just wanted to maybe ask you about whether nature can help cities to heal in the way that maybe can deal with this pollution that people are struggling to deal with the chemicals, with the metals and everything. Well, if you have any information about maybe that kind of an impact that landscape design is doing.
I don't have the answer, but I wanted to share with you that when I came to live in my house, 300 years old, and I'm living from the old town.
Mm-hmm.
So it's giving me a perspective for everything else. Because I know that that tree was, you know, in the 18th century when Casanova was walking, you know, next to it. So it's something which is giving me like a constant.
Oh, yeah, I think that definitely, like, that we can talk about fetal remediation, of course, like in the sense of how powerful our plants in kind of adapting and cleansing the environment in this kind of like performative, almost exploitative thinking that we connect towards them. We investigated a lot the power of hydrobotany in being able to clean a river or pond absorbing like heavy metals, which are like dispersed in water bodies by any sort of pollution coming both from industry or like discharge domestic nature. But I think that like in a sense, this healing is also in healing of the soul with like the presence of nature in a city that immediately made us domesticating a city which is linked to a tragedy. Like in a sense, like this Alina's lessons of planting trees which would grow very fast immediately and then being supplanted by the other ones that would grow a little bit slower, or planting trees that were like already 30 years old and finding like all these sort of systems for bringing back nature as fast as possible. And we didn't even mention the kindergartens. She was championing among European landscape designers the design of a certain type of kindergartens that were implemented in the aftermath of the war for having kids being able to play. Like the importance of the reintroducing play, and in this play there was always the project, like the tiny pond for the kids, the tiny sandbank, and a tiny hill for the sledge and the trees all around. So in a sense, nature helps very much infants to cope and to being able to enjoy outdoorsness.
And also this act of care when everyone together planting trees or something, which also brings community back together. And this act of care about the nature that cares about you because of creating a certain atmosphere. So questions, please. Я також можу вам допомогти з переглядом, якщо
можна. Thank you very much for this amazing lecture. While listening to you, I thought that your work is very much based like on kind of a very strong tradition, because thinking about Lina Scholz, I was imagining that her work impacted very much the image of Warsaw and not only Warsaw, and therefore she was like in a way powerful, and therefore it maybe indicates kind of a trend that were important maybe in Polish society at that time. And I just wonder, maybe I am mistaken, but it seemed that now somehow this focus from the nature has shifted. And maybe you have any idea when exactly did it happen, because even showing these pictures of the university, this like basin for architects to study how to aquaplant and so on and so forth, I was thinking that it's also something that indicates this approach and the shift of the focuses in architecture itself or in urbanism. So how do you think it shifted for some reason, and why, and when, and why today we are not focusing that much on nature?
Okay, so for the Pedro Modali, we are sure that it happened in the 80s. Because it's not only about the Polish context, but as for the Spain, we're collecting, for example, the images of the modern icons, like Le Corbusier, Gropius, the other museums, Wanderer buildings, Jakobsen. So like masters of modern movement, they were using water plants because they didn't use chemistry and electricity to clean up the water. For them it was natural. You had the ground, you had the ground plants. You had the water, you had the water plants. And it's there, it's in the historical pictures. And you know that they rebuilt the Mies Wanderer pavilion in the 80s, and they have improved Mies. So the pond was 1 meter before, I mean, originally, and they rebuilt it much shallow to find a space under for the pump, for the system for the swimming pool. So their mindset was already like that if you have water, because in Warsaw, that's fact that this greenery office was responsible for much bigger like amount of square kilometers. But in no book, which was like the, describing the effort of reconstruction, there was no single chapter on it. And in fact, we were shocked because it was not our task. Actually, it was Simone's idea who was researched on the exhibition. And even the landscape architecture department in Warsaw was annoyed that we as an architect we're doing an exhibition about the people that we have no idea about, and that they are creating that exhibition since 3 decades, which was not true because they didn't do that. But we understood that Alina Scholz and her office lost power in the middle of the 60s, because that was the moment when the official reconstruction finished. And then she was working mostly for the social estate designers as advisor. And even as she was working at the beginning of the 80s, with very progressive research, which is considered like the most unfinished project maybe also. It was still communistic time, still we had like a central planning, and still we had like financed by the municipality, like the multidisciplinary offices. And she was advising the office which was created by the botanists, zoologists, anthropologists, architects. So she was working in a very experimental, big organization that was creating like a experimental at the time proposal for the new estates in Warsaw. But with the collapse of the communism, all that work went into the drawers, and then it was completely forgotten. And now we're talking to some elderly architects that this is for them it's really pity that there was not this continuity, because with the new market economy, new offices started to be present, and this market economy was so aggressive that everybody was looking for a commission as a small entity, and there was no frames to work in such a constellation. And what happened, I mean, in Poland there is no landscape architecture at all. There is this faculty, very small one, there are not even independent faculty now. The students of the faculty, they're telling us that they are treated as a, someone who is putting the rose at the end of the investment, not as a decoration. That it's not that, it's not obvious that we're supposed to put in on the landscape first, water circulation, wind, and then finding the places for the buildings. There is an investment, and there's some business, you know, cover on top of it. So they're always like called too late, they have no resources, and it's pointless. So this is what we trying to do with the students of property and architecture as well, to try to find a way, again, to cooperate much more with the landscape architects. We were as well so ignorant a few years ago that we were like trying to grow a green part of our projects by ourselves, because we're architects, we can know. We know how to put the tree, no? On the plant. And now working with the Natalia Budnik, we know that we have no idea about all those like natural processes. We're trying to learn from her, from the shops, but we are really like, you know, acting like we're
looking
forward.
Yeah. You said a lot, so I cannot add anything to answer to this question, but like, I have like maybe two small kind of strand of thoughts, like about what you said that landscape architects had some power. Also, this is maybe a little bit of a myth in a sense that a way in which we wanted to name this exhibition at the very beginning was not Greener and Greener, but was actually Jeremiada, like the Greenery Lady, because this is the way she was called, and the other women involved in landscape design were involved also in modernity. in a sense that which was always like a little bit patronizing, a little bit diminishing, you know, always a little bit on the shadow of the main important architects. So in a sense, like maybe this, the fact that they had power is questionable, but for sure, because of central planning and a certain, like let's say, bureaucratic structure of the state apparatus, there was some agency, let's say that they had agency. But in a sense, what Gosha mentioned of the fact that the kind of the split between the let's say that I think that there's several traditions. We can talk about the Polish tradition, we can talk about the French tradition, the Dutch tradition, or the British tradition. So there's several traditions in which landscape architecture and architecture enter into the dialogue or into the sort of like dependency from one another. And in some countries, it's better than in others. I mean, this is still in the alive in the tradition. But when it comes for like the one that we know best, maybe the Polish, the Italian one, I have to say that with the great acceleration and the boom of the population, somehow this shift, I don't know if I can speculate here, but I feel that the shift in attention toward the landscape went into agroforestry and abandoned the city as a subject where architecture became dominant. So it was much more important to feed people and to take care of like planning the countryside rather than to keep on working on the city as a living environment. So this is where I see maybe the rift, the split. And nowadays, actually, the landscape faculty of Warsaw is branded as the University of the Life Sciences. So maybe we can kind of see a kind of a return into a more humanistic approach towards like the garden as a own kind of environment. So the city maybe is not like just like a concretion of a materiality of a geological stone which are constructed into buildings, but we can think of our cities also as a forest. So our city is also a garden in a sense.
Isn't the plan of, or is it part of the zoning? Because as far as I know, some European cities have like this greenery layer, let's say, in their zoning. So protecting biodiversity and so on and so forth. Isn't the case? Because you were mentioning this is very fragmented, you know.
Planning doesn't exist in Poland.
Okay. next question, please.
And I would like to ask, it seems that Alina Scholz was paid a lot of attention to details and thinking perspective of time, how all of that will look like. But I just wondering, probably it's naive and childish question, but I think in Ukraine and in Poland as well, there is a long season when trees do not have leaves, like winter is quite long, and probably you have learned from her some insights from this period of time, because you said she was called greenery lady, but in fact they like trees for a long time do not have leaves in our part of the world, and have you learned from her something about that? Thank you.
Thank
Yeah. I think it's very important that like this on the kind of line of work that we're trying to push right now. I mean, we didn't present any project connected with that, but we're trying to work with the aesthetic of the city and with the soil as a living organism and the way that like the mud and what's happening, all this part of the dormant kind of nature, besides the cyclicity of it, it needs to be brought back to the urban imaginary as something that we can cherish, because like this, this in fact this time of over rotting means fostering new life and closing the cycle. And the fact that the urban nature is often time sort of like focused on clean cleanliness or like the disposing of leaves in autumn or like tending in a way of aestheticizing the greenery is something that we strongly claim to the birth, also to this project of the tiny urban pot. In fact, during the winter we need to winter the pot. That means emptying it from water, covering it from leaves, and leaving the plants retreating into the mud and staying warm in this kind of composting, rotting environment for several months. Even lately, the pot has been vandalized, and somebody brought with the marker on the edge of it, what's this shit? What is this shit? In a sense, because during the December and January month, it just looks like a pile of dirt. It's just rotten leaves covered with like dry branches. This is how nature looks like during the winter, and we have to be okay with it. This is the message.
Thank you. We have time for maybe one final very short question. If anyone has one? If not, yeah, please.
Yeah, thank you so much for the presentation. It was awesome. Yeah, and actually we discussed with Danilo that it was the best presentation Isha had in these 2 years. Yeah, so I wanted to ask actually, like you told about like your working experience with that Natalia, if I'm not mistaken, and that you are like learning a lot from her. And I wanted to ask like about, I guess, Ukrainian perspective on that matter, this landscape architecture or like overall landscape we are creating in the cities. Who should like advocate for that or take responsibility for that? For creating these like green spaces, let's put it like that, in a city, if not architects, because like we don't have strong landscape learning school or something. So what should we do with that?
Maybe some idea for the course.
We actually asked for it, to be honest, this year. Yeah. So yeah, that's a question. Thank you.
Thank you for the question. Of the politics of the urban planning and who can work with it. Actually, in our experience, even if you have like a very open-minded and very, let's say, proactive administration, oftentimes activism is the way to go. We have in, the force of the grandmas with the root to go over the Rotman Gardens. Well, that's another story, but like basically, maybe I can share with you the fact for our local experience, there is like activist groups, third sector, which are very much engaged in promoting urban nature, and they're doing so by, oftentimes, I don't know if you heard of the personalization of nature, oftentimes of changing like natural elements from an object to a subject, trying to advocate for like rights, like global rights for nature as a being. We are like river sisters in a city, which is a group of women which are trying to advocate for the rights of the regional rivers, the one that exist and the one that don't exist anymore. Another activist group which is trying to advocate for a specific wetland for the city to finally buy it and transform it eventually, or not transform it, but rather preserve it and popularize it as a popular, important ecosystem. So in a sense, you can always work, there's never like one body that takes care of this. There's like multiple, let's say, agencies, public agencies or like collective initiative that can simultaneously act from the different directions and maybe obtain something at the very end.
Natalia was studying in Copenhagen and she spent her 8 years there practicing, and she came back to Warsaw like 3 years ago, like 2013. So she's external as well, she has this external eye because of her experiences. And we don't know, like a person who was trained in Warsaw with such a sensitivity as Natalia has. That's one thing, that it's a side note. She's she's like shaped by that Copenhagen experience. But we did not, we have not, I mean, 2 years ago we had no idea to whom to talk with. And in fact, the best allies till now are the scientists. Are the activists that rooted in the biological faculty. And before we had no, like, I never had the idea to go to the different faculties as you have today. To like to talk to people who know something about a subject that we have no idea about. But with the greenery we were so lost that we started to attend lectures at the biological faculty, and actually we ended up on the Wetlands Day. It was 2018 or 2019, I guess, that we understood that there is like a huge subject that architects are blind to, which is the preservation of the wetlands, and we asked them if we can work together on the urban context. And for them that was like a strange, because they didn't consider urban wetlands as something that they can work with, but then they understood the educational potential of it. And now there is like a, it's called web coalition, in between them, in between other activists who are like into the wet spaces, and they organizing a lot of like walks to the urban wetlands, and they're advising us how not to, even with a good intention, not to harm those ecosystems with our project, because you know, for the first walk there is 30 people coming, for the second walk 300 people is coming. So we are not making a dead walk. No, because you know. But yeah, so I think that you can, you don't even know how many allies around you have. And at least in our experience it was like that.
Oh, maybe I just wanted to add like a big note about discussing with the biologists. I think it's super interesting. It's super interesting that when you're approaching a subject which is so gathers the attention of so many members of the society at different scales with different expertise, you also encounter very many different languages around which with which you speak about the subject. So if you're talking about a tree, if you're talking about that very same tree with like a passersby, with a biologist, with an artist, from the architectural perspective, the interesting part is when all this language kind of meet and you say, ah, you said that in this way, because we call it this way. So and then you start to kind of like kind of embrace their point of view on something that you firstly never thought it would be called that way and never had this importance. So this constant inter-exchange between like the activists that most often are coming from the field of applied arts, or the biologists that are coming from this kind of nerd very scientific terminology, architects which have their own full literature and historiography, and when this dialogue happens is when like the best sort of serendipity triggers.
Yeah, an anecdote is that for the hydrologist, the healthy tree is minus 300 liters of water per day.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Especially on ending on this very positive note of inviting interdisciplinarity in the architectural profession as a way to deal with all the difficulties we have in our cities and beyond right now. So I don't have to say to you that it was one of the best lectures that you had, because you already heard it from our students, and I can assure you that we can trust. They're always honest. So thank you so much also to our guests for being with us, for taking part in this discussion, and we'll see you again at our next